Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very pleased that you've come out today. My name is Dennis Bevington. I'm the Member of Parliament for the Northwest Territories, and I'm very pleased to have had the opportunity to host this forum on healthcare in the North and in Canada. Healthcare, of course, is and our public health system is something that Canadians universally hold in great esteem. Some days that when we look at the statistics that we have, we wonder how well we're doing with healthcare, how well it's holding up to the ever-increasing costs that we have in the system, to the needs that we have in an aging population, and those concerns are with us every day. Over the last number of years, we've seen an increase in federal funding for healthcare, 6% a year over as an escalator that has been in place. We're going to see that escalator come to an end in 2016. And that has concern for my party, the New Democratic Party, I'm sure for everyone in the country. How is this going to work? What is the state of healthcare now? How will it deal with ever-rising costs in the future who's going to pay? How can we make our system work better? We're not ranked as the highest quality health system in the world anymore. We're down the list of ways, and I'm sure people will talk about that today, but that's a concern that we all have. I have a concern around health, just as anyone else does who's entering their middle age or older. But I have a concern for my grandchildren as well. The fundamentals of our public health system have built a strong country in Canada. When we look at the difference between us and the United States when it comes to what is more important, the lower taxes for corporations or the public health system that saves the cost for the workers in the system so much, I'd say that it's the public health system that's more important to make our economy competitive and productive in North America. But those are only some of the things that go on around it. In the North, we know that we have issues. You can look at the latest report from the provinces and territories, and it's quite clearly identified that rural and remote communities across northern Canada simply do not have the level of health care that's required. There's about 300 communities that I think if you realistically looked at, rural and remote northern communities, there's about 300 across the north of Canada, including the northern provinces, and that area is of course where we live, and it has the types of issues that we're going to hear about today and I'm very glad to have our Andrew Corriveau here, public health officer, going to make a presentation on some of those statistics for the Northwest Territories. I'm very pleased as well to have our critic, Libby Davies here, who has held that portfolio for the last...
Since the election
in 2011, and has been a member of Parliament, of course, for a very long time. And will certainly carries the weight of authority. She's been our House Leader, she's been a number of things in Parliament, and has always been a strong spokesperson for public health in Canada. We have Ben McDonald, who's going to give us a presentation from Alternatives North, and Sandra Lockhart with the Public Service Alliance of Canada. So I'll introduce everyone in turn, but I'm very pleased that we have a turnout here today, and I'll turn it over to Libby Davies to carry forward from here.
Well, thank you very much, Dennis. I don't know if I even need a microphone, but
Is it better with or without?
With.
All right. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you all very much for coming here today. I'm very appreciative of the fact that it's Saturday afternoon and you could be at home scrubbing the floors or something, making cookies, I don't know, doing laundry, or you could be outside. It's a real pleasure to be here in Yellowknife. This is only the third time I've ever been here. I was here in August though, so I got to experience the wonderful summer weather, and it was particularly good in August. I came to the Canadian Medical Association conference, which was just really quite incredible, and drove around, and I just think it's beautiful up here. I've already been taking photographs on my Twitter. Anybody on Twitter here? Okay. And sent it back to all my followers in Vancouver and said, look at this sunshine on the trees and the lake, and I'm sure it's raining in Vancouver. So I was trying to make them jealous. Then I said, well, it is minus 31. So, but I'm heading home tomorrow. But I'm just really delighted to be up here, and I'm very appreciative to the fact that my good friend and colleague, Dennis Bevington, who I first met in 2006, when he was elected, and you know, we are from incredibly different ridings. My riding, Vancouver East, is sort of the inner city of Vancouver. It includes the downtown east side that you hear about so often in the news, where people have died of drug overdoses. We have InSite, the safe injection site. So I represent a very small but high population, about 120,000 people. But I can zip back and forth in my riding like 30 minutes. Dennis, well, you know what Dennis represents, you're here. But I have to say that over the years, he and I have worked together on many issues. We see eye to eye on a lot of stuff, right, Dennis? We get into trouble sometimes together, which I think is a good sign. I think that's a healthy sign if you get into a little bit of trouble now and again. But I've really come to appreciate, and certainly within our caucus, which is now 102, you should know that Dennis is an incredible voice for the North. It's a very strong voice in our caucus. So I'm very, very proud to be here with Dennis today, and also to share the platform. And I just want to say that Dr. Andre Corriveau, your public health officer, I had the pleasure of hearing him on a video conference just a few weeks ago. I'm on the health committee for Parliament, of course, and we're doing a study on healthcare innovation. And so Dr. Corriveau made a really fantastic presentation, and so I'm very happy to be sharing the platform with all of you today, because I know we all believe very much in what we're talking about in terms of healthcare, but we have different roles, and so it's good to hear these different perspectives. So I want to begin my remarks by just reminding us that last year, because we're now just in 2013, but 2012 was the 50th anniversary of Medicare in Canada. Medicare began in Saskatchewan with Tommy Douglas, and in fact many people consider Tommy Douglas the father of Medicare in Canada. And I still talk to seniors who remember what it was like in this country before there was Medicare. They had to make choice between food on the table or seeing a doctor or trying to get to a hospital. So it isn't that long ago, 50 years. I remember meeting two elderly doctors now in Saskatoon who came from the UK, both doctors, a husband and wife, who came to help Tommy Douglas when he had the famous doctor's strike. And they picked up roots from the UK, they came out to the prairies, and they came to help him, and they set up their practice, and they're still there today, two wonderful people. You know, Tommy Douglas always knew that what he was bringing about was only the beginning of a bigger vision. And I just want to quote from a conference that he was at in 1979, he was still alive, very active. And I like this quote because it really tells us what his vision was. And he says, and this is when he spoke at this conference, those of us who talked about Medicare in the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, kept reminding the public that there were two phases to Medicare. The first phase was to remove financial barriers from those who provide healthcare services to those who need them. But we pointed out repeatedly, he says, that phase two would be much more difficult. It would be to alter our delivery system to reduce costs and to put an emphasis on preventative care. So that's Tommy Douglas in 1979, and had that vision of what healthcare was about. Now, what is also very clear is that we could not have achieved what we have today in terms of our public healthcare system without, in fact, what we call Tommy Douglas's phase one, without the federal government. There is clearly a federal role in our healthcare system. And we won't be able to get to Medicare 2.0, if you like, that second phase that Tommy talked about, without a federal government that is willing to consult, to work, and to show leadership and to actually bring it about. You know, I've been reading a great little book. It's called A Healthy Society, How to Focus on Health, How a Focus on Health Can Revive Canadian Democracy. So that's a good thing, tying health issues to democracy, by Dr. Ryan Miley, who's a community health center physician in Saskatoon. And in actual fact, he had a book launch here in August in Yellowknife at the bookseller, which I attended when I was at the CMA. And in that book, he makes some very interesting observations about our healthcare system. And what he says is, Small-scale efforts across the country have shown how changes to the current system can improve the quality, the accessibility, and the affordability of healthcare. But what is needed is a scaling up of those localized success stories to a national level. And that's really what my work is about as the official opposition health critic for the NDP, is to think about health and healthcare from a national or federal perspective. Now, we know that healthcare is a top priority for Canadians. Every single poll that is ever done puts it at the top. But one of the challenges that we're facing is that it hasn't been a priority for the government that we have in power right now. And in fact, they've been backing away from healthcare. They've ignored the 2004 health accords, and some people may remember that. There was sort of a big agreement between the feds, the provinces, the territories, about what needed to be done in healthcare in 2004. Things like, you know, a national drug plan, home care, better accessibility, electronic health records, better accessibility for remote communities in the north. Many of those things have actually not been implemented. And that's because the federal government has basically been backing away from its responsibility in healthcare. And in fact, as Dennis pointed out in his introduction, a year ago, the finance minister, Mr. Flaherty, basically announced a new funding formula and said, well, here you are, guys, take it. And when the provinces and the territories looked at that formula, they figured out that in the long run, it will shortchange the provinces and the territories by about $30 billion. So that's a big gap that has a lot of the premiers, the territories, very concerned about what's going to happen to our healthcare system. And I would go so far as to say that I think the federal government has forgotten the five principles of the Canada Health Act. I'll just remind us what they are. Universality, comprehensiveness, accessibility, portability, and publicly administered. That's what the Canada Health Act, which is a national piece of legislation and is meant to hold our healthcare system together, that's what it's based on, those five principles. So we have right now a federal government that I believe is trying to dismantle our public healthcare system. And I think we need to understand that by doing so, by kind of walking away from the table, and taking this hands-off and disengaged response, they're also dismantling a very core values of Canadian society. This isn't just about healthcare. It's about who we are as a Canadian society. And what are some of those values? Well, fairness, equality, accessibility, and the collective good. And Dennis mentioned what it's like in the United States where 50 million people don't have healthcare coverage. And if, you know, even if you do, you're paying hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of dollars a month for your coverage, and you're worrying about whether you have to mortgage your house if you get sick. So our healthcare system, our public healthcare system, is based on some very core values. In fact, Roy Romano expressed that very strongly. Some people may remember the Royal Commission on Healthcare, 2002, an incredible document, and he really used those values to talk about what needed to be done in the future. Now, I don't know about you, but I find it pretty creepy that we have a government in Ottawa that is willing to spend $28 million celebrating the War of 1812, and they didn't do one single thing to recognize the 50th anniversary of Medicare. Nothing. It's like it didn't exist. So we do have a huge challenge before us. It's a challenge that is both political, but it's also systemic. We do know, and I think we're going to hear this from our speakers today, we know we need to modernize the Medicare system, in effect, to get to that phase two that Tommy Douglas was talking about, but we don't want to throw the system out. We don't want to cave into all of the assertions that you hear over and over again, that the healthcare system cannot be sustained, that it's broke, and that therefore we have to privatize. There's so much evidence and research to show us that this is not the case. So we do have to recognize that some very powerful forces at work who would like this to happen. There's actually billions of dollars at stake, whether it's in drug costs, whether it's in, you know, how we deliver healthcare. This is a very big business. I've got another little book here, written by Dr. Michael Rackless and Hugh McKenzie. It's called The Sustainability of Medicare. Wonderful little book that does all the research. And what they say, and there's tons of stuff in there, but they say, healthcare costs have been increasing as a share of public revenue, not because healthcare costs have gone up relative to the size of our economy, but because government revenue from taxation has been going down relative to the size of the economy. So a much more thoughtful analysis about what's going on. Nevertheless, the challenges are very real, whether it's privatization, whether it is increasing costs because of decreasing revenue, whether it's because of inefficiencies, whether it's because of regional inequalities, which are actually huge across Canada. The fact is the system isn't working the way it should. When a cancer patient in New Brunswick can't afford the average cost of $60,000 in medication, and they're actually advised to move to BC, where the coverage is free, the system's not working. And it isn't working when over 5 million Canadians don't have access to a family physician. And it isn't working when more and more families, and I know that this is an issue in NWT, when more and more families are taking on at least a financial burden of what's called informal care, which is caring for aging parents, or when 25 to 30% of hospital beds and ER rooms are used when people should be in home care, long-term care, or recovering at home. And it isn't, and it absolutely isn't working when young Ashley Smith, who I'm sure you've been reading about, and there's a whole inquest going on, died in prison when she should have received the mental health care that she needed. So the system, now those are only a few examples. So it's not only the system of healthcare that we must transform, but I think the way we approach our health. We always talk about the healthcare system, but our health as well, in a holistic sense, is something that we need to focus on. That's exactly what Tommy Douglas was talking about in the 40s and in the 1960s when he brought in phase one. So when we look at our healthcare system and our health, we have to focus on issues like growing income inequality. We have to look at issues like the appalling social and economic conditions of First Nations, and this is a direct federal responsibility. The federal government itself is the fifth largest healthcare provider in the country to veterans, RCMP, First Nations. We have to look at things like decent jobs, housing, good food, security, food security. These are all things that I know are very, you know, that people debate and think about and work on in the North. All of these things are elements of a healthy society focused on well-being, disease prevention, and especially chronic conditions, which are now escalating at an alarming rate, like diabetes, high blood pressure, and of course issues like mental illness that have had such little attention, and is now, you know, every one of us knows somebody who has been touched or affected or is coping with some sort of mental illness. So I want to end my remarks by talking about why I'm here doing this and why I'm talking about healthcare. Because the NDP, we have a campaign underway. We call it Healthcare, Now is the Time. And I've brought along some issue sheets. They're at the back, and I'd love you to take them. Mine's in color. Unfortunately, yours is not. But it's the same material. And in those issue sheets, we lay out some of the key issues that I've spent a little bit of time talking about, and what we think needs to be done, whether it's better drug coverage, whether it's having an agreement for long-term care, continuing care, whether it's focusing much more on primary health care in a multidisciplinary way, so you can go to a community health center so that people aren't feeling like they have to go to the ER. And I think finally, and you'll see this in our issue sheet, paying attention to what we call the social determinants of health, the foundation, because they do matter. You know, you've heard that adage, an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure, and that's still true today. So what we're doing is we're holding forums across the country. I think this is now my sixth or seventh one. I'm going to be in Toronto in the next couple of weeks, and we're going out talking to Canadians about healthcare. There's a vacuum right now. The health accords that I spoke about earlier are going to come due in 2014. So what's going to happen? Will we end up with 13 different healthcare systems in this country? Or will we still have those basic core values outlined in the Canada Health Act? And will we have a modern system that Tommy Douglas talked about? So that's the challenge before us. I'm very proud of the fact that the NDP is leading the way on this. We want to go out and talk to people. I want to hear from you. I have little cards on both tables where you can take it away. Write me a comment. Tell me what you think is the priority in terms of healthcare. And then just drop it in the mail. No postage required. So there is a choice between, I think, what the current government is doing, where they've walked away from healthcare and said, hey, this isn't our bag. This isn't our responsibility. And a party that is saying that healthcare is a federal responsibility to work cooperatively with the provinces, with the territories, with all of the stakeholders, and to make sure that these core Canadian values that we've talked about today are the core of our healthcare system, and to make sure that Canadians have access to a system that is sustainable, affordable, and high quality no matter where you live. To me, this is one of the most important things because we live in such a huge, diverse country. So it's not about looking backwards. As I think, you know, sometimes critics say, oh, they just want to go back to the good old days. No, it's about looking forwards. It's actually about looking at the vision that Tommy Douglas had, because he was a visionary, and what he understood needed to happen in our healthcare system, and how we needed to focus on disease prevention and health promotion. So those are some of the things that we're talking about. I really appreciate that you are here today. Please fill out comment cards, get it back to myself or to Dennis, and let us know what you think, because at the end of this year, we're going to put out more material, and we're going to say, this is what Canadians told us. And as we go into that next federal campaign, I want to make sure that healthcare is something that's on the top of people's minds about what they want to see, because it's not too late. So now is the time. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Libby, and and your passion, of course, for this issue is one that I think that you have a real opportunity to share.
Are we catching it?
Yeah, we're about it now. So your passion, you're sharing it with the rest of the country on this issue, which of course drives so much of our concerns. We have a panel today of Northerners to speak to us on health issues. And our first speaker is going to be Dr. Andre Corriveau, who's the Public Health Network Council Provincial Territorial Co-Chair, as well as, of course, as our Chief Medical Officer of Health in the Northwest Territories. And I'm sure everyone in here knows him well because he's been here since 1998 as the Chief Medical Officer of Health in the Northwest Territories, and he's worked throughout the North and has lived in the Northwest Territories since 1998. He took some time over the last 3 years to become the Chief Medical Officer of Health for the province of Alberta, and I'm really glad that he's back here in the Northwest Territories because, of course, he's done such a great job for us. And